Thank you so much, Jim. Wonderful. Appreciate your work and your presentation today. And at this point, I'm going to invite our panelists to come forward. We're going to be joined here on the platform by Gerard Brumfield, Mark Farrell, Megan Hackman, and Fred Leon. If y'all would come up. There's microphones on the chairs for you. Wonderful. We're going to continue our conversation on closing the generation gap in leadership. And as we get started, could we just go around and introduce yourself and tell us where you serve the Lord?
Okay. I am Fred Leon. I'm retired teaching elder out of the Presbytery of the West, and I minister with our presbytery, with the denomination, and I work in a secular part-time job also.
My name is Mark Farrell. I'm a teaching elder at Tampa Covenant Church, Tampa, Florida.
Hey, and Mark and I, is this on? Do I need to? So Mark and I went to seminary together, and he was every preaching professor's favorite. It was like, why can't y'all be more like Mark? Look at what Mark did there. You need to take notes from Mark. So it's good to see him again.
I'm Megan Hackman. I'm a teaching elder in Port Orchard, Washington, and I'm pastoring a baby church plant.
And I'm Gerard Brumfield, and I work for the CCO at First Presbyterian Church in Fresno.
Thank you. I love all the love we're getting from the assembly here for our panelists. Well, you know, we're talking about wanting to close this gap in passing the baton on in terms of leadership in the church. It's something that's been on a lot of our minds as we look at what we call the pipeline problem. Jim, you referenced the fact that many seminaries are seeing fewer and fewer students interested in going into pastoral ministry. Meanwhile, we've got a lot of baby boomer pastors getting ready to retire, and so we get concerned sometimes about that gap. So sometimes it helps us to look back at how the Lord has worked in the past to remind us of his faithfulness going forward. So I'd love to hear you all talk about how you were handed the baton in terms of ministry leadership, and then how you're seeking to pass it on to others.
Well, I'll go. I'm very fortunate that I actually serve in the church that I grew up in as an adult, young adult, age 18, as a matter of fact, and served 22 years in the Air Force. But while I was at the church, I was actually de-churched, joined the Air Force, and my parents said, hey, we found a good church. You need to come. And I just left the house, and I'm being invited back to church, but I went anyways. And so as I went back to the church, the very first thing that hit me was the very first time in my life I heard the gospel explained. And so that was a hook. And then people came alongside of me. Well, I was still doing my thing after church, of course. But then the Lord got a hold of me, as we would say, and that's when the discipleship process really started in my life. And there are many people in our church today that still remember me as a knucklehead 18-year-old. And so sometimes it's a little difficult to preach, but we get through. But over the years, I've been able to reproduce disciples by the grace of God. There's a young man that's sitting out here right now that was a part of our youth group when he was 11 years old. And he became a youth intern. We stayed together. He discerned a call to ministry, went to seminary, graduated seminary, and now he's an ordained pastor in the EPC.
Well, mine's not dissimilar, so I'll just piggyback off of that, because the college ministry that my husband and I were a part of was linked to a local church, Signal Mountain Prez, Chattanooga, and that pastor in that session believed in us and called ministry, saw ministry in us, supported us going to seminary, helped us find a way to get there, paid for us to come to General Assembly every year while we were in seminary so that we could make the relationships that we had to be able to connect to a church at Chapel Hill in Gig Harbor, Washington, who met us here and didn't think it was a crazy idea to hire some 30-year-olds to come and serve on their staff. So they took a big risk with us. EPC hadn't seen an ordained couple at the time, and so they let us, Larry and I, figure out our call and support us all the way through. And now we've brought our own this GA. So
I think in the statistic of not wanting to be a senior pastor, I think I'm one of those people who just like, I'm avoiding everything to go to seminary. So I don't know what it was, is that people invested in me to be my gift of knowing how to love people well and wanting to figure out how to help me begin to be in those spaces. So loving college students was my college minister who said, you can do this. I can show you how you can do this. Gave me an awkward email that made me do this, and now I'm here still loving college students 12 years later. But it's this idea of loving college students that feels passionate to me, and being a pastor actually feels very intimidating. It's something I currently have no desire to do.
Well, when I was pastoring full-time, it was in the Denver metro area, so we had the opportunity to invite Denver Seminary students to intern at the church where I was pastoring, and a number of those students went on to become EPC pastors. I think there's a few here today, and I think investing wisely into their lives, giving them opportunities not just in children's ministries, but to preach and to do significant other ministry was really timely for them and a blessing for us.
And Jim, how about for you?
So I grew up at First Presbyterian Church Orlando, and the gospel did not take, and that is on me. And I went to Florida State, which is where I became a Christian, as one does at Florida State. And it was through the ministry of Campus Crusade, and I was discipled. And it was interesting then going back to First Pres when I would visit home, because I was excited to go to church, and I got to know David Swanson and Case Thorpe, and they would resource and invest in me along with the Campus Crusade people, and that was really where things changed drastically.
Oh, that's great to hear. What are you all seeing in terms of trends among the people you know who are re-engaging the church, or what are some ways that you or your church are helping coming alongside people who are re-exploring the faith?
You know, I think what's helpful, what we heard today, is it's not a one-size-fits-all presentation when we speak to those who have left the church and are currently de-churched. And I love that rubric that Jim gave us in the form of questions, so we can pinpoint, hey, we don't have to give right out the three circles. This is just a simple invite right here. And we can do the hard work in understanding the context that we're in and the conversations that we ought to have. And something I'll be talking about later on is when Jim said there are going to be some people that require a dinner table, and that means that we have to have margin in our lives to be able to be hospitable to those who are really considering what it means to come back to church. And so as a pastor, I think that missional conversation needs to continue in our congregations, and people need to understand it and live it.
I think it's one at a time instead of trying to get everyone to come back. So something that's been really interesting to me as I see, and I work with 18 to 25 year olds for the most part. Most of the time when you're having a conversation with them, you ask them about their like church experience. They tell you all these things, and then you have the deeper the conversation goes, they're like, wait, I think I can come to church with you. I'm like, yes, I want you to come to church with me and give it a shot. Instead of trying to have the one-size-fits-all model to say, like, what it's like to have one conversation, say, and this matters to you. I'm going to keep talking to you until you come with me. Instead of trying to say, like, well, if you're not going to come, I'm going to go to the next person, is taking the one step at a time, one person at a time.
I don't know if our context in the Pacific Northwest is a little different, but one of the things that we're noticing is that people are deeply spiritual. They really feel a connection to something other, and that's being defined in a lot of different ways. And if you walked through my town, you'd see opportunities to have your future read, right? Or to join it's the summer solstice. You could go to a summer solstice overnight. And I think actually awakening to realizing that that's not something to work against, it's something to work with. And so when you notice that God is drawing out people, when they're calling for something more, we talk about introducing your friends to each other, to Jesus, and to his church. And so I think following Jesus is the most abundant way. And a lot of people are not going to be able to hear even the name of Jesus until they know that your circle of friends isn't weird or a cult or, you know, whatever else. And so I'm really grateful. One of our elders that's here with us, I would say he and his wife have a really thriving backyard ministry. And I don't think as I think through the friends I've met at their Christmas parties and their summer movies, I can't think of any of them that would name a church home. But they've been introduced to the community of Kitsap House, and maybe we're a little less weird. But they're deeply spiritual, and I believe that the Lord is calling them. And so work with the Lord. Anticipate that the Lord is ahead of you in those conversations.
Can I say one more thing? I've just been very shocked with the amount of students who have said they tried so many other things and nothing else was working until they came to, someone invited them to come to church with them. So specifically thinking of a student who's like, I went to the Mormon church, and she's like, I was looking for Jesus, but it wasn't that Jesus. Like, you know what I mean? Like, she like was trying all these different things, and then when she's now come to our church and has been in these conversations, but like, I think this is where I want to be. What does baptism look like? What does it look like for me to be a part of this community? So it's interesting to think she was once in church, left, and now it's like on this journey of trying to figure it out in a space that feels safe to her.
So I would affirm that, like, if you're going to ask me the number one thing, it's relationships. So y'all said it, so I get to say something else. I think there's a conversation to be had about how do we leverage technology in a helpful way. Now, here's my most unpopular opinion, and so if you disagree with me, you're in the majority, I'm in the minority. We have cut live streaming completely, and we leverage technology in lots of ways. We leverage technology. Our sermons go up on Tuesdays. You know, we have podcasts, we have all these things, but what people are missing is the embodied worship that we're designed to be a part of. You can't be with God's saints, you can't experience the sacraments, no one's going to know if you're in or out, you know, if you're not there. And so really, as a form of discipleship, we turned it off and found it to be very beneficial in the life of our church. So my unpopular opinion, it's okay if you disagree.
It sounded like you had some resonance in the crowd, though.
I heard a little bit.
I don't think you're on that island alone, Jim. Fred, how about for you in this season of your ministry? I know you were in pulpit ministry for many, many years, and now you're serving the Lord in a secular job. Tell us a little bit about what you're noticing with the people you know there.
Yeah, thank you. This is the AARP perspective. and I'm probably the one most qualified up here to speak to that. I retired May 31st, 2000, and 2020, and took a year off, gap year, just to make sure I was mentally and emotionally okay, and I was. And then I went to work for a running store. My avocation is long distance running, and I began to build relationships with some of the employees there, my coworkers, and three really quick, brief stories. So the first coworker is a Korean who was raised in Ecuador and then came to the United States when she was 18, single mom now, and she was raised in the church. And when she came to the United States, she experienced racism for the first time in her life and in the church. And her comment to me was, I'll never trust Christians again. Second co-worker, she and her family, when the pandemic came, that was their excuse. We don't have any more connection with our church. They built new friendships in their neighborhood. When the pandemic essentially was over, their kids got back into volleyball and soccer and hockey and all that, and their friendships became the sports community that their kids were engaged with. The third family unit, they were attending a church, and 5 years ago, the pastor was terminated, and it divided the congregation, and not only divided the congregation, it divided their small group, and the people that they were friends with, they became hostile with one another, and instead of looking at what do we have in common, they were only focused on what divides us. And so the single mom, 3 years of investing in her, listening well, asking questions, And just a couple of months ago, she said to me, "Fred, I might consider coming to a church service if you were preaching. Might." Second family, been investing in them for about 2 years now. And my coworker said, "You know, I think we need to get back to the Bible. Could you recommend a Bible for us to purchase?" So 2 years, 3 years of effort, 2 years of effort, and the third family, where the division occurred, a year and a half been working with this coworker, and they said to me, "Can you give us some churches that we might visit, because we're thinking about attending?" But it's all relationship as far from my perspective, listening well, asking probing questions. Giving some challenges, finding the triggers that are going to build those connections, and the trust factor. Oh, you listen, you're interested, and I think those things are important. In spite of me, God is doing some work there.
Praise the Lord. Fred, thank you for sharing those stories. Really, really encouraging to hear. Jim, one of the things that I really appreciate about your book, you have a lot of data. You give us a cold splash of water in the face in terms of where we are, but it's so hopeful. It's not a story of doom and gloom. And there's a point in the book where you say something to the effect of, you know, this could be the start of something really special. In the last chapter of The Great Dechurching, there's this statement: "The way forward is not by creating something completely new, but by returning to something very old." Mm-hmm. So I'd love to hear from each of you a reflection on what you see in terms of the opportunities before us, and what might the Lord be inviting us into in this season of ministry.
Well, at our church, we take our liturgy seriously. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's gathering, word, table, and sending, and you know that has stood the test of time. Some of the things that Jim said about being confessional is completely true, and we absolutely believe in that. But we also have to be missional, and what does obedience to the Great Commission and the Great Commandment entail? I think sometimes that we may feel, If we build it, they would come. You know, what Jim already said is what you win them with, you win them to. And if we opt for those things, when culture shifts, that means that we have to shift with culture to make sure that we're staying relevant. Mm-hmm. But what if we stay with what has been tried and true for the millennia of church history, it's something for us to hold on to. Mm-hmm. The fact of prayer and being I was convicted when you talked about, because we pray every Monday as a session, but when you said praying through that directory, that is something that this pastor needs to learn and practice. And just good old-fashioned equipping the saints to live missionally and following up and being accountable to those things. So stick with you know, what is objectively true and has been true of the church over the years.
You know, I would echo that comment. One of my favorite questions to ask believers and the de-churched and the unchurched is, how is it with your soul? To get down to the matter of the heart. And even with unbelievers, there's a response that I get. It's not offensive to them, because I think we all want to be known, and this is one way that we can open up the door to further and deeper communication.
It's a good season to learn. It's a good season to try something new. We're coming out of a lot of things. The more that you say doesn't work, the more I'm like, cool, let's go try something that does. So we do a lot of trying at our church, and I hope that there's a lot of freedom in that for all of us, established churches and new churches alike. You can try something. And a lot of those things that we're trying are old. So we're doing Practicing the Way. If any of you guys want to engage that material out of Oregon, we're having fun with that. We are doing a residency with young adults who are practicing a common rule. And I know you could talk to me or Gerard about that, because about engaging this young crew, belonging, really finding family, offering an alternative to the nuclear family that hasn't always worked for everybody in this generation. And so try something new, and something might just stick. The residency for us was built out of, I couldn't pay someone to meet anywhere during COVID in Washington State for two years, right? We just got into the school. The public school just reopened to us this year. So I hired a bunch of college students who were stuck at home and had so much fun delighting in the old way of college ministry, having them over for a meal, letting my neighbors who didn't know where they stood with the church cook with us and for us. And now some of those are part of the fellowship because they found purpose and belonging as well intergenerationally. So intergenerational, try something new, residency, common rule of life, practicing the way, the old stuff, communion every week, prayer, try it.
Yeah. For us, I think it's a few things. One, I have a pastor who has a very high IQ, NEQ, I meant to say. And he's really good at remembering each person's name. And whenever I bring a college student to church, he meets them, and then he says their name next time he sees them, and it makes them want to come back because the pastor remembered their name. And I don't have to, I didn't have to say, hey, pastor, you should do this thing. Yeah. He actually does it, which encouraged me to want to do it, and which watching other folks begin to do it. We also, the old thing is we've done Alpha, and Alpha just actually goes to the root of, here's the Bible, and here's the truth, and here's who God is, and students are, excited about, just knowing who God is. I'm like, oh, yeah, that's so simple, and I don't have to make it flashy. It's just watching a video and then talking for 10 minutes, and then they're like, yes, I want more of that.
Okay, so I want to tag on that, because one of the old things we brought back was I had a crew of people that, multiple generations, this was one of the interesting trends, I think, that when somebody comes back into the practice of the faith, then it tends to be intergenerational. Do y'all see that too? The parents mm-hmm. might come back, the kids might come back, brothers, sisters. So I had noticed this family coming back, so we just did Bible 101. I mean, I didn't even come up with a cool name. And I had three immediate households who all belonged to the same family there. And at the end of it, they were asking all these questions. And my favorite thing is, that's a good question. Anybody else ask that? Which I learned from Alpha. Yeah. And then I kind of started to wonder if the Alpha videos were a little too evangelical. If they were just a little too, here's our perspective. Did you like receiving that, you know? But then I showed them one of the Alpha videos after this. I was like, would you guys want to do this next? And they're like, that was amazing. Yeah. I was like, well, I guess it's time to bring Alpha back. There you go.
Yeah,
I remember writing that, and the main things that I had in my mind were evangelism and discipleship. And of course, the ways that those old practices play out, culture to culture, there are going to be some variations. But I remember, so Tim Keller has a quote, and he said it in the vein of contextualization, but I've kind of imported it into evangelism. So if you'll let me replace those two words, I'm going to say evangelism is knowing the stories of the people's lives that you're in and showing them how every one of those stories finds its best ending in Jesus. And you really have to, it's like making an introduction, you have to know the people and you have to know Jesus. And if you don't know either, you're going to be deficient in some way in making an introduction. But then in terms of discipleship, we tend to think, obviously our culture is changing rapidly. And you hear a lot of concern and fear over certain aspects of our culture change. But I would argue, I'm not trying to minimize that, there are other aspects that are maybe even bigger that we miss, children's travel sports and just the expectations that America puts on us that effectively takes us out of a regular worship routine. I had I didn't use her name, but there's a sweet woman in our school, and she came up to me and asked, Jim, would you ever have a Saturday evening service? And, of course, inside I'm thinking, with three teenagers and a nine-year-old, if I have a Saturday service, I'm already disqualified to be leading that service. But I just asked, what makes you want a Saturday service? And she said, and I'm not anti-Saturday services for what it's worth, but what makes you? And she said, well, my three kids are in seven travel leagues, and we're never here on Sunday morning, but once a month we're here on Sunday evening. And we'd love to be able to go to church that one day a month. And so that was it was like this moment. It's like, okay, the culture's winning here. And what does it look like in terms of discipleship to help people realize we're going to have to say no to some things, we're going to have to compromise places so that we can prioritize what's most important for us and for our kids?
Heard a lot of talk about the importance of relationship. And Mark, I think you earlier used the word margin, that we're going to need to put margin in our lives to be able to connect with people deeply, even to know them personally, to pray for them. What are some ways that the Lord has enabled you all to create just a little bit of margin so that you can connect relationally as you lead?
We had a church health training on Monday. I gave a devotional in Matthew 9. And if you go back and look at that entire chapter, I like to call it one busy day in the life of Jesus. I mean, everything is just connected with coordinating conjunctions. Jesus is going from here to there to there to there. And at the end, he says, harvest is plentiful, guys. Let's pray. Laborers are few. Pray to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. And one of the things that I said when we were together was, yeah, if we're going out to the harvest, you know, emotionally overloaded, physically overloaded, and financially in debt, then we're not going to be effective gospel laborers. And so it's not a matter of reducing stress. It is a matter of eliminating stress. And so how do we eliminate stress in our life? Well, we just have to stop doing those things that are causing stress. You know, how do you get margin on your money? Well, you just stop spending your money. And those are the type of decisions that if you want to be serious about being a gospel laborer, that we have to make personally in our lives in order to be obedient to what God is calling us to do, or in order to really live out what it means to be incarnational and in sharing the gospel with someone. So ruthlessly looking at what we're doing in light of what Jesus calls us to do and getting after it. That would be how to get some margin.
So I have the rear view mirror view of all this. And with taking some pastoral license here, love your neighbor as yourself. My philosophy has always been for all of us that we can only love others as effectively as we're loving ourselves, which means we need to take care of ourselves. We need to do that not only spiritually, but physically and emotionally and mentally. And that has to be, I know this is an oft-used word, but it has to be with intentionality. We need to learn to say no, and we need to very intentionally put margin into our lives for our family's sake and for the sake of the reputation of the name of God.
As someone who is not married and don't have kids, and it's just me out here living in the world, I think I try to do things, the margin I think is by inviting people into those spaces with me. So when I'm making dinner, I invite someone to come make dinner with me. When I'm going to go to a soccer game, I invite people to come to the soccer game with me. I try my best to not do things alone that I could do with other people, while also making sure that I have, like, something I've been learning over these last few years is still having Sabbath that I can go be alone. But if I'm working, that margin is inviting people into those spaces with me.
So I have not historically been a person that recognizes when I'm living past my margins well, and I don't know if this is the primary reason or not, but in December I had a massive heart attack and almost died, should have died, and it's a crazy story. But since then, the doctors have said you need to live in third gear for this year, and I don't like living in third gear. I don't naturally live in third gear well, but the longer I've been there, you know, third gear has meant prioritizing sleep, prioritizing exercise, prioritizing some things that I didn't necessarily prioritize well before. And the longer I'm in what we're calling third gear, I'm realizing, oh no, God's actually opened up my eyes to a healthier lifestyle, which opens the door to gospel fruit.
If you need some new running shoes,
yeah. Thank you.
Well, Well, we are going to take a moment of margin here for ourselves before we go on to lunch. But first, let's thank our panelists and thank Jim once again for this time. Thanks. We want to close out this session with just a couple of brief moments of prayer so that we can give the Holy Spirit an opportunity, thank you, to impress upon us anything that he might want us to take home today. So please join me in prayer. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to learn together today. As we seek to serve you in your church, we depend fully on the work of your Spirit in us and through us. And so we invite your Holy Spirit to solidify in our minds one thing that you would like us to ponder in the days and weeks ahead. God, we all know and love people who have walked away from the church. And so now in this moment, we silently lift up to you the names of those who we long to see abiding in you and bearing fruit. Lord, please open our eyes to the opportunities you have laid in front of us to pass the baton of faith to the next generation. Lord Jesus, please renew once again in us the joy of your salvation. Father, you have rescued us from the dominion of darkness, and you have brought us into the kingdom of your beloved Son, and so we thank you. As we go forward into this assembly, Lord, we pray for your guidance. Like Paul in his letter to the Philippians, this is our prayer, that our love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that we may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. And it is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.